Hallelujah. Looking for another outpouring of His Spirit tonight. Loving Hands is in the house. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank God. And have a great afternoon. So let's just enter into worship and let's let the Holy Ghost have His way tonight.
Yeah.
house on Sunday night. Amen. Right, yeah, we got some empty pews, but we got a lot of people here on Sunday night. Praise God. We got Loving Hands here. So I'm going to ask whoever will come up and help us in this choir tonight.
Go get him.
Out of the hymnal tonight, we're going to sing page 184, He Abides.
Yes,
somebody say praise the Lord.
Thank you.
Message 18.
Hallelujah.
Looking for
praise
sin.
The Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you. many of you are looking for a city? Amen. How many of you are looking for the mic to be turned on? Praise God. God's good to us, isn't he? Oh, I tell you, I've been thanking the Lord for his touch this morning. And I had several people tell me how much that the service meant to them. And even after the service, there were some that came and said, I really wish I had some of my kin folks, whether it's grandchildren, whoever it might be, could have heard that. Because I'm telling you that in this world that we live in, we need a friend.
Amen.
Amen. And so many times people think, well, the only friend I need is Jesus. Jesus did not design it to where that the only friend we needed is Jesus. He knew that you and I needed some mortal help.
That's right.
And thank God, because that we can find that mortal help in Christian friends, can't we? And I am just so thankful for the Word of God. I tell you, it's more precious to me than ever before as God just opens it up. I cannot get past the part where that this morning the Spirit of the Lord just kept dealing with my heart about Lazarus coming up out of that tomb and Jesus telling the people around him, said, loose him and let him go. I think it's the New Living Translation uses the word, says unwrap. And they would literally take clothing or particles of whatever they could a lot of times, and they would wrap people up in them after they died. And they would fill that with embalming spices and myrrh and everything else. But the Lord did not walk up there and take it off of him, did he? He sent the people up there. He said, go up there, get off those clothes, unwrap him, get it out of that. And I just believe that's what God's wanting to do to a lot of us. He's just wanting to unwrap us. Amen. And sometimes God may use you to unwrap somebody. I'm not so sure I want God to use me that way. Honey, you don't know what God can do through you. You'll just let him. But I want to be used of the Lord. Well, I'm not preaching it all over again tonight. But I sure am thankful that God has set my soul free. And I've been set free by the Master. Hallelujah. We want to worship God tonight through our tithe and our offering. Our ushers are coming at this time to serve you. Thank you so much. This past month, so many of you were so faithful in giving to God. And I just want to say thank you. God knows the needs of the church. God knows what all that we're having to do. And, you know, I'm just looking to God to really help us. It seems like every time that we about get one project called up, there's something else that begins to break down, tear up, or something happens. And but God's faithful. God's helping us get everything back together. And I just thank you for his grace and his mercy. How are you thankful today for the mercy of God?
Amen.
Amen. Brother Simmons, you moved on me. Pray for us.
Lord Father, I'm so thankful for this day that you've given us. I thank you for the word of God this morning. And God, I pray, God, that you bless our pastor tonight, God, as he brings the word. Whatever you have us to do tonight, God, we give you the glory and honor. God, bless these people tonight, God, each and every one that's here, God. God, if there's a need here, God, I pray you'd supply that need in their life. God, I pray for the offering you to your glory and honor. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
I really hope it's your desire also. Praise God. Let me take just a few moments here to make some very important announcements. These things were important. I did not realize that this weekend had already got up on us so fast. And starting Friday and Saturday and Sunday, we have plenty of things that's going on here around the church. Friday night is going to be our youth service. It starts at 7. And Brother Gavin is just inviting everyone to come out. Invite people to come. Okay, it's going to be centered around the youth. There's going to be preaching. There's going to be singing. And I just believe that God is really going to meet in a very special way. Then comes Saturday morning, Sister Diane has a group that will be going to More Than Words. Loving Hands is sponsoring that. And that's going to be at the Civic Center, right? And those of you that have already got with her, make sure that you know where you're going, when to be there, so that way you know how to get there. And then on that evening, we're going to be having Truck or Treat. That's going to be from 6 to 8. We have a lot of special things that's going to be going on there. And we're just asking those of you that can, by Wednesday, bring in as much candy as you can possibly bring in. We're going to be giving out to all the kids and people that come from the neighborhood. There's going to be a lot of food and just different activities. And then on Sunday night, the Pickering family is going to be with us. So I want you to invite people to come be with us on that. And I know that you're going to be blessed on the 21st. And and then, Brother Ed, you want to tell us about the 27th? We don't want nobody to get bored. That's the reason why we try to keep things going for you.
The best half of me is not here helping me with this tonight. So, but we want to mention the senior event that's coming up 2 weeks from yesterday on the 27th, October 27th. We are calling it It's Harvest Time. That's what we're calling this senior event. And we want you to, obviously, if you did not get one of these seniors, make sure you get with me. I have some with me. Because you want to bring this announcement with you. It's part of a drawing, okay? So make sure you get one of these from me if you don't have one. And we want to make sure we bring a dish. I tell you, last time, the seniors really showed up with lots of food. Amen? So bring a dish to share, and we'll be having some drawings. And invite a friend. You know, today's all about friends, and we've had a wonderful turnout today. But make sure you invite friends. They don't have to come to this church. They don't have to go to church at all. Just invite your friends, and let's get people in here that we can minister to. Amen? Amen. And I'm just expecting something. Chris and I have been doing our prayer time every night for over a month now, and we have an expectation in our spirit about this next senior event. So seniors, please come, because I'm expecting God to show up in a mighty way. Amen? Yes, we have a good time, but we also let the Holy Ghost have His way. So make sure you come 11 to 1. And make sure you also, seniors, bring one item, whether it's a canned good or a box good, for Sister Frieda and Brother Henry's baskets, Thanksgiving baskets. So we're asking every senior, besides the covered dish you bring an item that we can put in the baskets, okay? It's amazing all the stuff that's going on in church right now, amen? And then real quick, we'll probably expound on this a little more after October, but sharing the harvest is going to be our Thanksgiving Day outreach. And I'm telling you what, people are getting excited about this. We're getting more people signing up and wanting to do things. And I had several people come to me today, Brother Ed, what do you need? What can I do for you? And let me tell you, this is really going to be an incredible outreach. It really is. So that's going to be on Thanksgiving Day. We're going to feed people from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. When you see that list out there that Chris put together, that chart out there is this color, go out there and sign up. Even if you can't come, you know, if you've got a family event that day, we completely understand. But if you can bring a food product that's cooked, notice how I said cooked, make sure you bring it and drop it off with us. We'll be here as early as 9 o'clock that morning. And and you can help that way. Just sign up for one of the food items back there. We want more than one of everything because we're expecting to feed a lot of people. Amen? And so we're going to actually take food to shut-ins as well. And what I'll do with the team that's helping me, we'll sit down and have a meeting in November to go over who we're going to take, you know, food to or who we're going to bus in, because Brother Paul's going to help us with that. There's a lot going on here. There's a lot. This is just a few weeks. So be praying for Sister Chris and I as we go away this weekend. Praise God we get to go away for a little bit of respite time. I tell you, when you're in full-time care with your parents, and those of us in here that do that, we don't get a lot of breaks. Chris and I certainly haven't had hardly any breaks in the past several years. But we're going to leave on Thursday and come back on Monday. And we're just going to, I'm asking God to give us a time of rest and restoration. Amen. But I encourage you, husbands and wives, and maybe sometime I can expound on this. Find a time, if you're not already doing it, I imagine there's several that are doing it. But find a time to pray with each other, together, unto the Lord. I'm telling you, it is life-changing. It is life-changing. It'll transform your marriage. And you know, Chris and I have a pretty good marriage starting out. But you can always step it up more. You can actually get closer to each other. And so I just encourage you, and I am going to expand on this one night because I believe it's needed. It all stems from the kingdom man. The kingdom man study. I'd love to do that study again. I'm telling you, if you missed it, men, and I know there was only about 12, I think, that came, 10 or 12 men, it will transform your life from a man's perspective on whether you're single, how to be a kingdom man to find a kingdom woman, or whether you're married, how to be a kingdom man with your wife. Amen? So I just praise God. So remember, sharing the harvest, Thanksgiving Day, and then seniors, October 27th, don't miss it.
Amen. And I know that we started early this year on asking everyone to please help us out by bringing in canned goods. There is a list that came in the bulletin, and there's also a list out front that tells you what is needed to go in the basket. And if you do not feel like that you can go to the store and get all this stuff together, and you'd like to donate money toward that, just put it in a tithe envelope and just mark on their Thanksgiving basket. And if you give $50 toward that, that would probably help to really do what, a basket and a half at least, including the meat and the pies and all that. And it really depends upon the size of the family, because there's some of these families where that they are having to give larger amounts to make sure it's all covered. So it's an outreach, and I just think that God has been blessing us because of that. And so let's just keep working together. Pick up that bulletin. You'll see there that we're going to be having revival the 28th, and starting with Brother Elijah Higginbotham. Also, the ladies are going to be selling pumpkin rolls. We need everyone to start helping us sell on that. They're going to start baking on the 13th of November. They'll have them all ready to serve on the 16th. And so there's just a lot of things that's going on. And there's more announcements to be made, but I'm going to hold off on them. I just don't like getting into a whole lot of advertisement. But there's one thing I feel like God has put into my spirit, and I just want to make this available to you. A lot of people have different types of ministry. Okay, are you listening? A lot of people have different gifts. And I just feel like that God is going to help us to put together a team that is going to help in advertising our church and publications and promotions. And if you would like to be part of that team, I'd like for you to get with me. I'd really like to know that by the help and grace of God, that there are so many different ways I know through the media, and just, I'm not going to go into details on it, but so many different ways that we can really promote our church. And if you'd like to be part of that team, please get with me. I'd like to have a team of at least 3 to 5 people who would just really focus upon this with me and help us to where that we can effectively advertise what that we have going on here for the church. Now, you may say it sounds like a business. It is a business. It's God's business. I'm on business for the King, and I hope you are too. And I want people to know what God's doing and what God's doing through you and I and what God is doing through this church. Sister Taylor's come to sing for us this evening. And I just want you to keep your hearts and your minds upon the Lord. And let's just continue to worship God. Has God been good to you?
Amen.
Don't forget about the trunk or treat. I'm excited about that. You're going to get something sweet. So everybody come on out, okay?
Amen.
You hold my hand.
us to go to the Lord together in prayer. Brother Carl's had to leave. He's one of his girls is very sick. He's still throwing up and all. Wanting us to be praying for her. But I want us to really pray tonight for Brother and Sister Lay. God just really needs to move upon both of them. And I want us to pray that God bless them. And we have so many of our people that are going through so much physically. And we need the Lord to really just minister unto them. Brother John's mother has fallen twice here just in the past few days. And needs the Lord to really touch her body and the transition that's going on there. And my mom is still not doing good at all. And has to be praying for her. If you have a request tonight, let it be known by the lift of the hand. We always have time to pray, don't we? Always. Father, you're a God that knows the needs before we ever call upon you. And God, I realize tonight, Lord, that there are many. But God, you are a God who has power to answer every one of them. I'm asking you, Lord, to heal these tonight that are sick and afflicted in their body. I ask you, to God, to heal little Brandy. I ask you, to God, to touch her. I ask you, Lord, to place your hand on Brother and Sister Lane. I ask you, to God, to touch Sister Caldwell. I pray and ask you, to God, to touch Sister Cook. I ask you, Lord, to move to God, Lord, move to God upon these people. God, I ask you to touch Mama tonight, Lord. I just ask you, God, to move to God upon Sister Betty Moore. Lord, the needs are many. God, the Harris family tonight, Lord, the comfort that is needed there. God, will you touch them? I ask you to, God, let our hearts and minds be upon you tonight at this service, Lord, as we honor you. God, we honor you with the faith that we have. Pray and believe that God, you're going to do it. In Jesus' holy name. Amen and amen. You may be seated. glad we have a Heavenly Father that takes care of us, aren't you? Hallelujah. I want to ask you tonight to go with me to the book of 2 Kings, the 18th chapter. 2 Kings, chapter 18. Hallelujah. So glad that we have you come back out on this Sunday night. And I hope that you're glad to be here.
Amen.
Amen. You know, they used to have what we call dinner on the ground just about every Sunday. And people would pretty much just stay at church all day long. And I'm sure some of these young people are feeling that about right now. Feeling like they went home just for a little bit. In fact, we had some of them. I don't think everyone went home today.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a great thing. Hallelujah. We just stayed in the presence of the Lord all day. Be all right with
you.
I want to share with you tonight. Going back into God's Word. I want God to really help us. I want God to grow us. I want God to develop us. How many of you want to be developed?
Amen.
Have you ever noticed something that it's easy to get into a rut? It's easy to get there, isn't it? Anybody ever done any mud bogging?
Amen.
Yeah, it's fun. Yeah. I know, you might tear your truck up, but it sure is worth it. But the thing about mud bogging, we would always say, if we can move, we're not stuck.
Right?
I mean, sometimes we was only moving like this. But man, we was having fun. We was throwing mud everywhere. And as long as you can move just a little bit, and you kept rocking it. Finally, when we got to the place you couldn't rock no more, then we'd say, all right, we're stuck. We need some help getting out of there. But I think spiritually, if you're not careful, you can get to that place to where that you're stuck and you don't even realize it. Okay? You're not in a rut no more. You've just fallen into a hole. And you need God to help you out of it. Now, I want to read these scriptures to you tonight, and then I want to talk to you about only a piece of brass. Only a piece of brass. And whenever we read this text, then you want to understand where that we're coming from. Now, it came to pass in the third year of Hoshea, the son of Elah, king of Israel, that Hezekiah, the son of Ahaz, king of Judah, began to reign. 25 years old was he when he began to reign, and he reigned 29 years in Jerusalem. His mother's name also was Abi, the daughter of Zechariah. And he did that which was right in the sight of the Lord, according to all that David his father did. He removed the high places, broke the images, and cut down the groves, and break in pieces the brazen serpent that Moses had made. For unto those days the children of Israel did burn incense to it, and he called it the Hushtan. He trusted in the Lord God of Israel, so that after him was none like him among all the kings of Judah, nor any that were before him. For he clave to the Lord, departed not from following him, but kept his commandments which the Lord commanded Moses. And the Lord was with him, and he prospered whithersoever he went forth. And he rebelled against the king of Assyria, and served him not. I'd like for you to go back with me to verse number 4. He removed the high places, break the images, cut down the groves, and then here's emphasis put upon, he break in pieces the brazen serpent that Moses had made. I want you to think about just a moment how long Israel had held on to this serpent. I want you to think about how long they had held on to this serpent. It was something they brought out of the wilderness. Something they brought out of the wilderness. I want you to pray with me that God will help us tonight and give us understanding of His Word. Father, I want to thank You for Your love, Your grace, and Your mercy. I want to thank You, God, for giving us a wonderful day. You have allowed us to be back here tonight. But I need Your anointing. God, I need You, Lord, to touch us tonight that we can have an understanding of what the Scripture is saying. And God, that we'll also take a closer look at our life, because if there's one thing that I'm learning, God, that You're constantly just having to prune me, and Lord, You're constantly having to dig around me, and Lord, You're constantly, to God, having to do a work inside of me. But Lord, I want You to continue to do that. Lord, I do not want to become stale or stagnant. I want to be fruitful. God, I want fruit that will remain, and only You, dear God, can give such increase. I ask for that anointing tonight to open our eyes and stop our ears. Lord, that we can hear and receive the Word of God. And Father, we'll turn out to give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Whenever we were in Jacksonville back in the early 80s, there was a church that they were all the time doing some things. And in one service, I really believe that the pastor had God lay it upon his heart to bring in like a kiddie pool and announce that they were going to have a healing service. And it was to represent the pool of Bethesda and represent how that the angel would come and trouble the water, representing, you know, how that the Lord would hear them, go tell them, go wash, and all of these things. And I can understand him being obedient unto the Lord. And from my understanding, whenever that he first done this, that God honored his obedience. But Brother Ed, it wasn't long until he wanted to leave the pool set up. He wanted to leave the pool set up. And you may say, preacher, well, what's wrong with that? Well, God does not always go back and do the same thing that he did the first time. And if you're not careful, you get caught into a rut where that you think, all right, God did it one time. But as I already shared with you in the past, whenever God told them to march around the walls of Jericho, he never did tell them to march around the walls of no other city. He gave them a different plan for every battle that they would encounter. Sometimes it was to go up the middle. Sometimes it was to do a flank. Sometimes it was to come up from behind. Sometimes it was to wait and listen for the Lord moving amongst the top of the mulberry trees. But God would move. Now think about a time also, you know, coming up in the church, and many of you can relate probably a lot more to things than what I can, but I remember in times where that I've seen the ministers take things and lay them upon the carpet, and through the instruction of the Spirit of God, they would take oil and pour it upon that. And then they would ask those who had a special need to come and to stand in that place where that oil was applied. And God would move. But I've also saw some where that the end results was disastrous because they were not doing what God said. They only wanted to think that this is the way God wants to do it. And seen some of them leave streaks running in the carpet where that they had poured their oil and messed up the carpet in the church. And no end results was coming out of that. And so I can go on tonight, and I'm sure that you can too. But I want you to understand that God does not want any of us to get caught into a rut to where that we think that God always has to do it this way and God's always going to do it that way. I know that about every time that I begin to preach about tradition and things like that, that there's people that start getting tense because, you know, that's the way that we were brought up. But I want to share with you some things tonight, how easy it is to really grasp a hold to a brazen serpent and think that this is what God wanted us to do all the time. But in the days of Hezekiah, Hezekiah had some discernment. And in the time that God was speaking to him, he was amazed, no doubt, to realize that which they had brought out of the wilderness and had lost all of its effectiveness, because you can no longer run to it if you were bit by a serpent and receive your healing. But people had made it now an idol. And they were bringing offerings to it. They were sacrificing before this. Can you just back up with me a little bit? Whenever Samson is given the jawbone of an ass and he slays 1,000 men, it did not mean that was the weapon that God wanted him to use all the time. And it did not mean that he needed to put that weapon up on a shelf somewhere and say, this is a sacred jawbone of an ass. And anytime I think about I need victory, I go up there and touch that and I receive extra power. I don't think he did it. Am I right? What about the times whenever that they would bind him up with a new rope? I say, yeah, I can remember when God moved up on me and these ropes just snapped. I'm going to put them up here. And it's going to be a reminder. And any time that I think I need a breakthrough, I'm going to go back and touch those ropes and God's going to give me a breakthrough. Now you may say, preacher, this is senseless, is it? Because if you're not careful, you can say, well, God did it for me like this one time, and so I'm expecting God to do it like that again. But it does not always happen that way, does it? What about the rooster? You think that Peter wanted to go out, grab a hold of that rooster, and say, I'm going to take him to a taxidermist. I'm going to have him stuffed. And this guy is going to sit right here up on my lintels, and he's going to remind me. No, he didn't go and do that. He did not make it an idol. Well, come back to Balaam, a talking donkey. Yeah, we'd like to stuff him, wouldn't we? And put him up. And say, you remember, God can use something as dumb as an old donkey. God can use me. So let's bow before him and let's worship him. I want you to grasp a hold of something where that you may think it's so far out there, but really it's not. Because we as people, we are just like the children of Israel, where that if we're not careful, we get caught up in the same situation. Really though, whenever that you study about the brazen serpent, it was actually a testimony, a prophecy of what was to come in the New Testament. It was telling us, in fact, Jesus referred back to it in John 12 and 32, and he said, if I be lifted up from the earth, would draw all men unto me. So what is he talking about back in the wilderness? Look back in John chapter 3, verse 14 and 15. Has Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness? So even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Oh, now are you getting the picture? It was not made for them to worship. It was a point of prophecy that says there's coming a day where there is going to be a Redeemer that is going to be put upon a pole, and you're going to be able to look to him, and he will be able to save you. He'll be able to heal you. There's five things I want you to look at real quick with me about this. That as a serpent was lifted up on the pole or an ensign, so Jesus Christ was to be lifted up on that cross. Okay? Number two, that as the Israelites were to look at the brazen serpent, so sinners must look to Christ for salvation. Hallelujah. Number three, that as God provided no other remedy than this looking for the wounded Israelites, so he provided no other way of salvation than faith in the blood of his Son. In essence, whenever they got bit, if they wanted to live, they had to look on the brazen serpent. Friend, I want to tell you, there is no other remedy. I love the words of that song that says, there is a remedy, and his name is Jesus Christ. Amen? And if you are a sinner, you're going to have to look to that one that died on that old rugged cross. Number four, that as he who looked at the brazen serpent was cured and did live, so that he that believeth on the Lord Jesus Christ shall not perish, but have eternal life. And number five, that is neither the serpent nor looking at it, but the invisible power of God healed the people. So neither the cross nor merely him being crucified, but the pardon he has bought by his blood, communicated by the powerful moving of the Spirit of God, brings redemption unto every one of us. I could probably preach to you just from that one statement. Because I want you to understand, though it was a brazen serpent, and though it was an act of obedience, there was not any healing in that serpent. The only healing that came was through the power of God that was acted upon and that was energized through obedience. I'm telling you right now that the rock don't have any power, but there is a God that can move because that you've obeyed him, and the power of God can move in ways that blows our mind. It's the power of God that does it. It wasn't the jawbone of the ass that energized Samson. It was God that energized him. Come on. It was God talking through the donkey. It was God crowing through the rooster. It was God moving through the stone that came out of the sling of David. Oh, I know some people say, well, let's get the stone that came out of the forehead of Goliath and let's put it up in church. Let's go do all of our bowing and all of our worship. Friend, there is no power in that stone. The power comes through the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah, hallelujah. this was just one of the many miracles that God would work in the wilderness. The Word coming out of the rock. But you're not going to worship the rock. It was God that used the rock. Just like God used the serpent. And there were so many facts. And there were so many instruments. But when it came to that brazen serpent, there was something about it that just grasped a hold to the people's attention. I don't know if it was because of it being shiny. I don't know if it was because that they could have testimonies of my daddy, my granddaddy, and all of them looked at this thing and they were healed. And I just believe I can look at it today and be healed. I don't know what happened. But there's a danger whenever that we go to worshiping the creation rather than the Creator. There's a danger there. They worship what had been used of God instead of worshiping God Himself. Anytime that you go to worshiping anything but God, it is wrong. It's wrong. Hundreds of years later, when Hezekiah came to power, he found the people were still burning incense to it. Why didn't they leave it in the wilderness? Oh, I couldn't leave it in the wilderness. That's what my granddaddy had. I can't leave that in the wilderness. That's what my grandparents used. And what we've done, we've taken heirlooms and made them to become gods that we just don't think that we can get rid of. I know that you're not preaching to me, preacher. Well, in his move to reform and revive the people, Hezekiah began to break the brazen serpent in pieces. Now, I want you to picture this with me because, you know, in my ministry, I've done things that some people would have thought was just absolutely silly. And some people don't have no problem telling you how silly they think that you are. But I just begin to try to picture Hezekiah going out of breaking this serpent. And how many people were railing and how many people were hollering and how many people were screaming, "You're killing our God!" How many people was displeased? But it did not stop him from doing what was right. I remember shortly after that we went to Nocatee. There was a tree that was growing up right by the fellowship hall. It was an oak tree. And it had limbs going over the fellowship hall. And those limbs were rotting and falling down on top of that of the fellowship hall. And all I could picture is going out there one day, you know, and having a great big limb that is just falling right down, right through that thing, and then there's going to be major repairs. Well, I done the only sensible thing I know to do, and that is get out a chainsaw. Cut down a dying oak tree. After I cut it down, I found out that previous years the church almost split because one preacher wanted to cut it down. And I thought, well, I didn't get no permission. I didn't ask nobody. I just saw a tree that was dying and wouldn't cut it down. How many understand what I'm trying to tell you? I'm telling you, I've been in situations where that people were saying, if you do this in the church, I'm not coming back. Well, is that God in the church? No. And this is what Hezekiah is facing. But Hezekiah said, wait a minute. I want us to get close to God. I want the blessings of God, and you made this to be an idol. It does not have any power of healing. It's never had any power of healing. God is the only one that healed your grandpa, and God's the only one that healed your mama, and God's the only one that brought your daddy out of it. And it's the power of God. The power is not in any type of temporal or mechanical or any other object that you can see with your eyes. The power is in God. It's in God. Well, we always had a wooden pulpit, and bless God, we're going to have a wooden pulpit. We don't want one of those see-through pulpits. You just don't have no anointing whenever you've got a see-through pulpit. The anointing is not in the pulpit. The anointing comes when somebody gives a hold to the Father and the Holy Ghost begins to move. Right? My Lord, I'm going to tell you, I've been through this thing to where the transition has come. And I can remember how that they had songs about putting your songs upon the wall. And preachers preached against it. And now look at us. I mean, you know, we've really backslid. We're really sinning. We don't just have one screen, we have two screens. I want to see what you're seeing. Right? But you know what? Some people say, I like the old red back hymnal. Well, praise God. We've got the red back hymnal up on the screen, so that way now it's large enough that you can read it. Right? So I'm trying to tell you that there's so many people that have made things to be objects that has blocked the moving of God. And it's not the object. You hear me? You could have put the brazen serpent in some type of a museum and went by and looked at it and said, hey, you know what? I remember when God used that. But God's not using that no more. It belongs in a museum. And there's some things going on in our churches today that belong in a museum. And so here we are. Hezekiah's taken a bold step, hasn't he? Hezekiah acknowledged that it had its place in history, but God was not pleased with the fact that the people had taken what he used and took a really a great effectiveness and made it an object of their worship. And so here's the second thing I want you to look at. If you're not careful, you keep clinging to the old season. You keep clinging to the old things. And I know sometimes I'm guilty of referring back to the past, but I can't go back to the past. You can't go back to the past. No matter how great the past has been, it's over.
That's right.
All right? Lord, I could think about what I used to do when I was 20 years old. That's over. Right? There's some of you who said, well, I remember when I used to run jump hurdles. Well, praise God. Some of you maybe you want to still jump a hurdle. And there are some of us that would wish that hurdle would just fall over. Things happen. Times bring changes. And if we're not willing to go with the change, guess what? We're going to be in trouble. And what amazes me is that we are more accustomed to the changes that comes in the secular world, and we just don't think that God does any changes in the church. You know what I say? I say thank God for loving hands. That's right. Because I can remember whenever people had the mentality, bless God, God can deliver you, then you won't have to go nowhere. But the longer I live, I understand that God can deliver you, but God uses people and God uses organizations like Loving Hands to unwrap the garbage that sin has put around so many people's hearts and lives and said, hey, we want you to know that we're going to love you and God's going to use us. I know God's done a work in you, but God's going to use us to help you to get strong enough to where that you can stand on your feet. Right? Now, I've been in this thing all my life. And I'll be honest with you. I was brought up in that time whenever if God didn't do it, well, then there's no hope for you. But the more I studied this blessed book, the more I found out God said there's hope. But I'm not going to do everything because I called some of you to be doing it.
Come on.
Oh, now you really got quiet on me.
Amen. Come on.
God's called us to be ministers. The effectiveness comes through God working through us. That's where it becomes effective. And who knows, Brother Ed, you may be graduating up from seniors ministry. God may be using you to disciple somebody else, and you and Sister Chris move on into a different type of ministry. What are you trying to say, Brother Spratlin? Because God does not always keep you where you are. Sometimes we get in a rut thinking, well, this is where I've got to be. Oh, bless God, I've been a teacher here for 30 years. And the bad part about that, a lot of times teachers are still teaching what they taught 30 years ago.
Yeah.
And people are going through things that are different today.
That's right.
Hey, my preaching has changed since when I started preaching. Oh, preacher, that's bad. That means you compromised. No. When I first started preaching, the churches that I went to, some of them would go back and tell my dad, said, your son preaches basically the teachings of the church. And I felt like that's what God would have me to do. And we saw the results from that. We saw people getting saved. I didn't do it intentionally. I did not get out the minutes of the Church of God and say, all right, this is my outline, this is what I'm preaching. No, I preached on salvation. I preached on the baptism of the Holy Ghost. I preached on healing. In fact, the very theme verse that we had for our flyers that we sent out was coming from Psalms, where he said he sent his word and healed them and delivered them. And God moved. God used us. But I want to tell you what God has done. God has changed a lot of my messages to become relevant for the needs today. When I first got started preaching, I wasn't so much concerned with people being addicted to drugs. I wasn't so much concerned. Yes, there were people that were on drugs in the 80s. And I realized that in the 60s and also in the 50s, there was just a great change that began to take place in our culture. But God has been directing my ministry to where that I've seen things differently and I see different needs that are coming up. You know what? Even back when I was in the church, we did not have poor people and homeless people like we have them today. There is a greater need for a ministry to reach that place. And one thing I pray is this: God, I don't want a brazen serpent in my life. I don't want it to be that this is the way it was back then, so that's the way it's got to be right now. I'm telling you, I want to be led by the Spirit of God. I want to be led by the Spirit of God. And I cannot cling to an old season. God had moved on, but the people had remained in the wilderness spiritually. But God was not in the wilderness. Solomon had already built a temple. And they were supposed to be sacrificing to God in the temple. But some of them brought the serpent. Now, Heshem was the name of that serpent, and his name meant a brassy thing or only a piece of brass. Now that would really offend somebody. Oh, that's my God. No, that's just a piece of brass. No, that's my God. No, it's not. It's just a piece of metal. That's my God. No, it's not. He might have eyes, but he can't see. He might have ears, but he cannot hear. I'm telling you that the God that you and I should be serving is one that has eyes that see and ears that hear and hands that still reach out to us. And I want God to help me. It was God's way of reminding the people that he had chosen to use a wicked, beggarly element to do a job, but he never intended for it to be worshipped. Every now and then, God does use a man or an organization and even special moves of revival to bless his people. And what so sad is, from that comes idols that are built. Honor is given to the created rather than the creator. And this is happening today. You know, God takes a man from the backwoods somewhere, anoints him, he builds a ministry, and the next thing you know, he wants a Colosseum built in his name. Come on. Well, I believe in giving honor to whom honor is due. But the thing is, we're supposed to be doing this for Jesus Christ. And so if you're not careful, men have been exalted to the place to where people would rather go. We used to call it preacher religion. You know what I'm talking about, right? When the preacher left, everybody else left. I don't like the new preacher. Some of you need to be a preacher for a little bit and change churches and see how that feels. Yeah. I'm telling you that we don't need preacher religion. We need faith in Jesus Christ. And if you have your faith in Jesus Christ, guess what you're going to do? You're going to serve God no matter who God sends into your life. There's not always going to be a Moses. Sometimes God's going to send a Joshua. And there's not always going to be a Joshua. Sometimes God's going to send an Elijah. Sometimes God's going to use Elisha. Or God's going to use a Nathan, or God's going to use an Obed. God's going to use somebody else. And what we have to do is be sensitive enough to know that God has moved on. And we need to be following God. Oh, Jesus, help us. I know you're thinking this is a good thing. This is Sunday night instead of Sunday morning, right? Well, sometimes God has to allow these things to be broken so that way his blessings can flow. We have to look back to the source of the blessing. Where does that blessing come from? Where does your blessing come from? It is not in what you own. It's not in what you possess. The instrument does not contain the power. But God behind the instrument is the source of blessing.
Yes.
It's God that blesses.
Yes.
And if God wants to use a donkey to bless, if God wants to use a rooster to get a message across to you, it's God. It's not these things that are doing it. And amazingly, there's idols and there's sacred cows that have been found in the places today in the church.
Yep.
Now, that sacred cow is a good one to preach on, isn't it?
Yeah.
Because here it is, Israel's come out of Egypt, and they still want to worship the cow that was in Egypt. Israel has come out of Egypt, but they still want to worship the cow that was in Egypt. And there's those sacred cows that people have put up. These things are created. When we refuse to seek and secure the proceeding and the progressive word of God. I want to challenge you. Gavin, this is a challenge that's going to you. This is a challenge that's going to our teachers. If your knowledge is not increased in the word of God to where that you have something new to teach and to preach today than what you did 10 years ago, you're not doing nothing like you should be studying the word of God. So are you saying the message has changed? The message of Christ never changes. But how that we communicate that message will. You have a generation today that will not hear it like our grandparents heard it. Number one, this generation was not brought up like our grandparents were brought up. You know, they were brought up that you heard the man of God, you respect the word of God. In fact, I know that sometimes, you know, you may think that this is getting a little old here, but I can remember the time whenever that they had respect for the ministers. Yeah. And if a minister came around, they would say, shh, we don't talk that way. Man of God's around here. This generation, I run an old man off of the street, make him walk in a mud puddle so that way they'll walk on the sidewalk. I'm just telling you the truth. So what I'm trying to tell you is this. The other generation had a greater respect of the messenger. This generation is saying, show me. Tell me. Explain to me. We could get up years ago and preach, if you're a sinner, you're going to die and go to hell. Now they're saying, what's a sinner? What's hell? What's heaven? Am I telling you the truth? I'm telling you that we're not in a Christian nation like we want to think that we are. Not everybody out there knows about Jesus. Not everybody out there knows the Word of God. Not everybody knows about heaven. Not everybody knows about hell. And we as the children of God need to progress in the Word to where that we can talk to them and explain to them about hell, about redemption, about reconciliation, about the saving grace and the saving power of God. Yes, we need to increase in our knowledge. Also, you have to understand that the Word of God is progressive. God uses things for a season. Sometimes those seasons are short, sometimes they're long, but they are seasons nonetheless. I try to tell people I found that God has put people in my life for a season. Some of them have been there for a longer period of time than other people. God has put ministers in my life for a season. God has put friendships in my life for a season. Some of those are greater than others. But nonetheless, it is for a season. And I found out that even going through life, I have seasons of life. And this is all scriptural. It's all scriptural. And if we go through seasons, then we've got to understand what the Word of God's trying to tell us in Matthew 4:4. He said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. It's important for you to understand every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. God may tell you to go do something, but whenever you get there, He may give you further instructions. Okay? Let me give you a good illustration. God speaks unto Abraham and says, Abraham, I want you to take your son up to the top of the mountain and I want you to sacrifice him unto me. Abraham gets the wood together, gets the fire together, gets the knife together, the rope together, takes his son up to the top of the mountain. All right? A lot of people today would have killed Isaac, no matter the angel of the Lord said, they're hollering and saying, no! Because God said, take him up to the top of the mountain and kill him. And bless God, I'm taking him up and I'm killing him. And then God has him up on top of the mountain and he's saying, no, Abraham, I see now that you're willing to obey me. I have a ram over here that you can sacrifice, and I do not want you to kill your son. Preacher, you're really getting confused because I don't think God ever changed his mind. Sometimes God does things to test us, to try us. Right? My Lord, I wish I had the time just to preach on this for a while. Because you look at Joseph. God gave unto him the vision. God gave him a vision of years that were to come. It might have been 20 years later. But nevertheless, that would be fulfilled. But what happened in between that time? He had to learn to listen to God. There was times where God would speak to him and say, Joseph, you need to interpret this dream. And Joseph, this is about to take place. And all of these things. Joseph had to learn that the Word of God is a progressive Word. And so we wait for his instructions. We listen to him that he may give us those instructions. But if we're not in constant communion with God, we will live in the past and we will build altars to the things that God is no longer using because we've not heard a fresh word from the Lord. This is the reason why I find it in my life. I have to pray. This is the reason I find it in my life. Now, Sister Pauline, I've got to read this blessed book. It has to be a fresh. I have to have a fresh touch of God. I do. And even since I've been here, I know that at times God has given me instructions and said, this is what you need to do. But listen, if I did not go back before him, I'd have no further instructions. And so I have to keep going back and saying, all right, God, so what's the next step? And God may give me an overall vision of what he wants to do for the church. But I have to go back to him for the guidance on how to accomplish. How to get to where that God wants us to go. God is wanting to do a progressive work in your life. He does not want you to grab a hold of a brazen serpent and set it up and say, this is what God's using and this is the only thing God's going to use. No, God does not work that way. He does not work that way. God wants to speak to you. There's some people today in the church that will not get any closer to God because they will not receive a new word from God. They won't. And I don't mean to sound repetitious, but this is something I've told Gavin, and this is something I've been trying to tell Dustin. As young ministers, you are going to do things different than what us old men do. You're going to face mountains that we've never had to face because of the culture that is changing in America. And the way that you present the Word of God is going to have to become maybe just a little bit different in order for it to be effective. But nevertheless, the Word of God is still going to be effective.
That's right.
And you find this throughout the Old Testament. You really do. You look how that God used Joseph to get him to the point that he needed to go. And then you see how that God used Elijah. And once again, God could have sent rain, God could have sent fire, God could have killed the 450 prophets and all of that. But you know what God did to Elijah? He said, you go back and find Ahab and tell him I'm going to send rain. When he finds Ahab, he said, all right, let's get the 450 prophets together and let's see which God will answer by fire. And then he gets the 450 prophets together and he kills them. Right? And then he goes to the top of the mountain. And he doesn't go up there and just sit. He goes up there and prays. God, you said that you're going to send the rain. Tells his servant, go look. Finally, on the seventh time, his servant said, I see the cloud about the size of a man's hand. Then he said, now it's time for us to run. There were so many steps here that Elijah has been praying. He knew that God was going to send the rain, but he had to go step by step. I'm trying to tell you, if he had held on to the brazen serpent, nothing would have ever happened. Nothing. But because he was willing to listen to God, God sent the rain, and you find the anointing of God upon him so strong until he's able to outrun the horses. Church, wake up. Let's realize this, that through obedience unto God, God gives us the power to be effective, and that anointing causes us to outrun even the enemy and puts us a step ahead of the devil. But you can't do it if you don't pray. You cannot do it if you do not allow God to move through you.
Yes, amen.
Like for someone to come to the piano for me, if you will. Let me just share this with you. I wasn't there. I remember my dad and them talking about how that they used to go to church and God would get to moving and some of the things that people would do. And I know that I've seen people run, and it's amazing to me how that some of them can run the back of the pew and never fall. You know, you get to thinking, Lord, if you're not in the Spirit, you're going to break your neck. But I remember them talking about how that they used to get that old potbelly stove, and it would be red hot. And they said those people would get dancing in the Spirit and run up there and grab that potbelly stove and just hug it. They'd walk away from it. Their clothes wouldn't be burned. I mean, it wouldn't be scorched. They wouldn't smell like fire. Their hands would not be burned. But church, we don't have a potbelly stove. We don't have a potbelly stove to prove that we are in the Spirit. I'm not condemning those days. I'm not downing those days. But thank God for central air and heat.
Yes.
Right? Thank God for that. And thank God I don't have to go out and handle rattlesnakes just to prove that I'm a child of God. But God can use us in different ways. God can express His power through us in different ways. How is that? I believe that God wants to do that differently, according to the gifts and the callings that He gives unto you in your life. Right? Why would God anoint you to sing if He's called you to teach? Right? Why would God anoint you to teach if He's called you to be a witness on the outside of the church? And honestly, I really envy Sister Frieda. I do. Sister, not everybody can go out there and meet up with the strangers and love on them and talk to them about Jesus like you all do. You and Brother Henry. That is a special calling. That is a special gift. Not everybody feels comfortable in doing street ministry. Am I right? Not everybody feels comfortable in doing street ministry. In fact, some of you guys maybe say, well, I don't feel real comfortable about doing that. I feel more comfortable about doing this. But the thing is, God's put a different calling upon all of our life. And the calling that He has put there, we need to pray that God will use us in that calling and not get stuck in a rut. But God, let my ministry be fresh. Let my ministry be exciting. Let my ministry be filled with zeal. Lord, let my ministry be appealing to others that they may not come to me, but they may come to You. After all, it's all about Jesus. It's all about Jesus. Stand with me, please. I want Jesus to use me. I want Jesus to use you. And the only way that's ever going to happen is if I will worship the Creator and not the creation. I will worship the Creator and not the creature. And I will not do anything to try to bring glory or praise to the creature. But all the praise and the glory goes to the Creator. That's where it belongs. I want God to use me. But I want to be hid behind the cross. And for a long time, I didn't understand those old timers whenever they would get up and preach and I'd hear them pray, hide me behind the cross. You know what they were saying? Don't let them see me. Let them see Jesus. That's where I'm at. It doesn't matter if you see me. I want you to see Jesus. It's Jesus that said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. My job is to elevate him. My job is to pick him up. My job is to exalt him. He's the Savior. He's the Redeemer. He's the healer. I don't want to be the brazen serpent. I don't want to be the object that somebody looks to and says, oh, well, you got to go to the preacher if you want God to touch you. No, no, no. I want you to understand God can touch you anywhere. I'm just a vessel. And God has many of those. And you're one of those. Father, I've preached tonight, Lord, what you've laid on my heart to preach. I've shared with these people to God what you've allowed me to share with them tonight. But God, I want us to grow in you. I'm praying, Lord, please, God, for every leader of this church, every teacher, every person to God that is participating in any type of ministry, God, for you to put it in their heart to be praying, God, use me. Show me new ways to God that you can use me. Show me new ways, God. I just want to be used of you. Lord, help me to reach out to others, to disciple others, to teach them the ways of God. But God, I also understand that everyone has to be taught a little bit differently. God, some of them may be hands-on. Some of God can just have something explained to them and get it. But God, help me. Help me, Lord, not to think it has to all be done one way. But Lord, let me be sensitive unto your spirit, for you're the God that works in so many different ways. And Lord, I really want to be used of you. I really do, God. I want to be used of you. I want you tonight, if you really want God to use you, will you come and just stand here across the front of the church with me? Come on, I'm not going to ask you to kneel. In fact, I don't want you to kneel. I want you to just come stand. Come on, if you really want to be used of God, just come on and stand up here with me. Lord, this should be 120%. Everybody in the world want to be used of God. I know that sometimes we sing the song that says, Jesus, use me. And if you really listen to the words of Jesus, use me, well then, Lord, it talks about even if it's to go across the sea. That says, anywhere you want me to go, Lord, anything that you want me to do, I give myself to you. And I love that song. I give myself to you, Lord. I give myself away. I want God to use me. I want God to use me. If some of you want to come on up here closer to the altar, that's fine. Gentlemen, if I can get you just to slide forward a little bit, then others can come up here behind you. Jesus, use me. Jesus, use me. This prayer has to come from your heart tonight. This prayer has to come from your heart. For you to really pray and say, Lord, I want to be used of you. I don't want to get caught in a rut. God, show me what I need to do. But I really want to be used of you. To every one of you that are teaching the girls' clubs and the boys' clubs and Sunday school teachers, kids' church teachers, I want to tell you, you have a challenge on your hand. It seems like every time another generation comes along, there's a different challenge there. But God can help you to minister to every generation. God can anoint you to minister to every generation. And I want you to pray that. God, I want you to help me to minister to this generation that I'm ministering to right now. Come on, help me pray. Father, I want you, Lord, to use the Samuset Church of God. I want you, Lord, to challenge us. I want you, Lord, to use us. God, there is a generation today that needs you. And Lord, there is a way to communicate the gospel to them. There's a way to God to get them to understand the love of Jesus Christ. There's a way to God to get them, Lord, to comprehend how much that, Lord, you love them so much until you was willing to die for them so that way they would not have to die. God, I'm asking you, Lord, to move. I'm asking you, God, tonight, Lord, to speak unto us that we may be servants of you. My Lord, as you were speaking to James and John, and then you speak unto Peter and Andrew, and Lord, that Paul would come along and God, all of their ministry, families were different. God, as you sent them, Lord, to minister unto others. Paul said that I have become like the Romans. I have become like the Greeks, whatever it takes. Lord, use me. Lord, I pray, God, that this will be the heart of this church. Lord, to whoever that we need to minister to, that God, that you will help us, Lord, to be what we need to be, to minister to those people. My Lord, help us to minister to all walks of life, God, whether they would be poor, Lord, or whether that they would be rich. My Lord, unto you, God, be given all the glory and all the honor. Father, Lord, unto the one that God, that may have a strong addiction. One that God, that may be battling things. One that God, that may look and say, that I don't see a need for Christ, for I have no sin. I've always been good. My God, you know how to minister unto every one of these. Lord, we just want to be used of you. God, I'm asking you to use this church. I'm asking you, God, Lord, to help us, Lord, to see ministries birthed out of this church. God, ministries birthed out of this church, God. My God, ministries that are effective. Ministries to God that are reaching the youth. Ministries to God that are reaching those that are in addiction. Ministries to God that are reaching those to God that are wounded. Those that are torn. Those that are broken. But ministry to God that reaches a generation, that reaches a people of today. God, use us. Make me more to be sensitive unto you as a leader, as a pastor. God, to take this church to where that you want us to go. Father, Lord, not to be just a church, but God, that is stuck away in the community. And here, my God, would there be a lighthouse right here? God, in that light would be bright. That God, that this surrounding house is not to stop the light that is given for the glory and the honor of God. God, in this morning, I want you, God, to use this church. God, I want you to use this church. God, use us. God, use us. Please, God, use us. God, please, use us.
So easy, oh God, take my heart, take my life,
Jesus, Holy Ghost,
as a
Lord, not careful, you can get yourself into a rut to where that you just don't feel like that God is using you, or you cannot be effective, and it's because that you've not been sensitive to the Spirit of God. It would be so easy for this church right here to get into a rut and say, all right, God, we're going to be comfortable with the ones that we have coming, and Lord, we thank you for all of those that are attending, but God, help us to never get to that place. Help us. You know what I want to see? I want to see people that I don't know and you don't know coming in and sitting upon our pews. I want God to help us to reach the unchurched. I thank God for every one of you. And I know that some of you have come from other churches. I'm not grumbling. I'm not complaining. But church, we have a destiny that's been given unto us by God. And that is to reach the lost. We need to reach the unchurched. And I thank God so much because of ministries like Loving Hands. Because they're not looking for perfect people. They're looking for imperfect people. Gentlemen, I hope that don't offend you. But I tell you what, unless we realize our need for God, then we'll never seek God. And unless the church realizes that the church was never organized just to bless the saints, but the church has been set in order by God to preach this gospel to the lost. We're supposed to be alive unto the world. We're supposed to be helping hands unto those that don't know Jesus. And I want God to help me to do that. I do. I want some new testimonies. God's going to take some of you out of a box if you'll let Him. That's scary, isn't it? It always scares me. God takes me out of my comfort zone. But you know what? That's whenever God can use us. Because we yield ourselves to God and say, God, we've got to have your blessings. We've got to have your blessings. As you go tonight, I want you to leave this place saying, Jesus really used me. It's not just a song I'm singing. It's not just a prayer I'm praying. But Lord, I really want to be used of you. Show me, Lord. Show me how that I can be used of you in an effective way. Okay, I don't want to just speak words into the air. I want to be effective for God. And I know that you do too. Right? If I'm going to drive a nail in something, I don't want to just drive a nail in a board that's not going to be used. How many understand what I'm saying? Sometimes Jaden wants to build something and I'm looking at what he's building and I'm thinking, what is it? And then sometimes he just, it's like that he's just trying to put two boards together that doesn't form anything, but he's just driving a nail. And if we're not careful, that's what we do. We just try to put something together that does not form to anything. I want it to form to what God is doing. I want it to start bringing to a completion. There has to be a plan. And if we follow the plan of God, it leads to a building. It leads to a growth. It leads to something that exalts and honors the Lord Jesus Christ. Not just in the church, in your personal life. Let God build your life to where that is a life that comes together. And you can see meaning in what God is doing in your life. God bless you tonight as you go. Shake hands with one another. And if you have an enemy here, make sure that they are your friend before that you leave. God bless you. Thank you.